one message going out, one person hearing it, and how it's flowing out and making the ripple effect to many others in the community that's impacting and changing people's lives. Whereas our impact before was in a small part of the Southern Amazon Basin, now our impact is worldwide. If the Lord's calling you to whatever it may be in your personal walk with the Lord, say, here I am.
Thank you for joining Mercy Today. How do mercy and compassion break down barriers and change everything? How do they bring hope? Be inspired as our guests share about the life-changing, soul-impacting work through the Ministry of Mercy, Inc. and its partners. Here's your host, Dr. Dan Critches.
Well, welcome. We're glad to have you join us for this episode of Mercy Today Radio. We get to tell the story of how compassion changes everything. We get to tell the world about the great work of Mercy, Inc. and the partners. And so one of the primary partners of Mercy is One Mission Society. And I'll say it full this time. We might often refer to it as OMS, but it's One Mission Society. And this mission organization has work in over 50 countries. And what they do is evangelism, disciple making, and church planting. Might be some other things that we'll hear from our guest today. But it's basically helping people come to faith in Christ. It's helping them to follow Jesus in obedience, and it's gathering them together in groups called churches. And churches, much different than in the American culture, where we have a building on a street somewhere and got the parking lot and the budget and the staff and all that. It's much different. Many of these are house churches or people sitting under a mango tree and doing a Bible study. So these are the key elements of a mission organization. And what we do is respond to Jesus' mandate to his followers. He said, make disciples of all nations. We call that the Great Commission. And this is redundant for those of you who are very familiar with this part of the world. But the Great Commission, making disciples of all nations. What we're really doing, we're not trying to sign people up for a religion. It is an invitation of a life in relationship with our Creator, and it is embracing and experiencing and trusting His extraordinary promises. That's the work of a mission organization. But how does all that get done? I mean, some people will pray for the work of missionaries and do that all over the world. Some will give to missionaries and mission organizations, and some will go. They'll feel the call, and they'll go to far-flung corners of the world. They'll do all kinds of, I say, crazy things, because in the world's estimate, those things do seem a little crazy. But there's a whole lot more that has to be done behind the scenes. And what I mean by that is most people never see some of the support and some of the work that has to be done behind the scenes. So the work of missionaries could not be done without this work. So the name of today's episode is The Invisible Force That Makes Missions Possible. So, listener, I want to invite you to lean in, listen with your heart, hear this discussion all the way to the end, because we have, zooming into the studio today, is Danny Beasley. Danny is the executive director of OMS USA, and I think I've expressed that a little bit. So, and OMS is a key partner of Mercy, so it's really important that we work together and we have those relationships. And again, today's episode is called The Invisible Force That Makes Missions Possible. Danny Beasley is our guest. Danny, thanks so much for zooming in today, and welcome to Mercy Today Radio.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Good to have you. So, appreciate you being here, and I'd like you to tell us first, I kind of made that framework about the behind the scenes, and you're the guy. So tell us a little bit in a nutshell what it is that you do with One Mission Society.
Well, I could give the really quick one-word answer is I sit in an office and make decisions.
Okay.
But a little bit more than that is as the executive director, I work with the Board of Trustees for One Mission Society USA. So which that would include the setting the direction, vision for the organization, the strategic planning, policies that would govern the OMS USA and its missionaries and staff, and then working with the board, then making sure that gets implemented throughout our headquarters staff and what we have control of and responsible for here at headquarters in Greenwood, Indiana.
There's a lot of moving parts there, and I can just picture some of them to the awareness that I have. But thank you for sharing that. And what I want to say for our listeners is you did not start out by aspiring to be in an office making decisions. You have a heart for missions, and you had a life in missions. So let's go there. So you told me that you had missionary service, or you were doing missionary work in Ecuador. So give us a brief nutshell about that.
Well, my wife came and I came on board with OMS, were accepted in 2012, went to language school in 2013, and we were late 40s at that point in time, and then went to Ecuador after our stint in language school in Costa Rica. And what we did is Julie is a CPA, and so her role was the field treasurer, field accountant, taking care of all the finances that would happen, the employee working with the government of Ecuador, making sure we were paying our employees correctly and maintaining everything. And my role was a district liaison. So the focus of that was to be the connection between the evangelical church in Ecuador, which OMS helped found about 50, almost 60 years ago, and between the mission and the churches in the what they called the Oriente district, meaning so which would have been the southern Amazon jungle. And as we were there and I was making a connection with the churches, I got built a relationship with a pastor who had been a part of the Evangelical Church Association, who was not pastoring a church, but he was building relationships in Shuar communities, going out planting house churches. And so not only did we work with what would be considered the mestizos in the more formal structured church, we did most of our work with the Shuar communities out in the jungle.
A lot of people, when they hear about Ecuador, they think, isn't that where Jim Elliot went? And we also hasten to add Elizabeth, but Jim and Elizabeth Elliot to the, I want to say Alca Indian tribe. Is that still the correct title for that?
Well, the Alca is actually a derogatory term that was attributed to them because of their very violent lifestyle.
Okay.
But the Waurani Indians would be the more common term in a more traditional way that would be a little more respectful.
Okay, good. Thank you for that clarification. So for those who know about the Jim Elliot story, Jim and Elizabeth Elliot, maybe recap that because we want to move on to your involvement in Ecuador and then go from there to where you are now. But give us a brief summary of the Jim and Elizabeth Elliot story.
Well, you can read the book Through Gates of Splendor or End of the Spear, or watch the movie to learn a little bit about it. But Jim Elliot and four other men, Nate Saint, Roger Udarian, Ed McCulley, and Pete Fleming, and their families all felt the need, the call to reach the Waurani Indians in the jungle, who there had not been successful communication with them and wanted to share the gospel with them. And as they eventually made contact through some really unique ways of doing that back in 1956, they made contact with a few and had some good communication. And then some in the community turned on them and speared them on the sandbar on the river and killed all five of the missionaries. It was made the cover of Time magazine back then. It was a huge impact and a huge influencing factor of a missions movement happening in the United States.
Yeah, indeed. And it's hard for me to realize that it was that long ago. It's almost 50 years ago now. You said 1956, right?
Correct.
Yeah. And I would like to encourage our listeners to go to YouTube and look up End of the Spear. I was able to find it. It's, an hour and 45 minutes or something like that, but full-length movie. And very inspirational and very moving. And I think that a lot of people have considered the mission field because of not just the work of Jim Elliot, but some of his very quotable quotes. And then, of course, Elizabeth and a lot of her teaching and writing and so forth. So I want to move from that to the task of world evangelization. Does we find that God kind of taps a person to the mission field and gives them some direction about where to serve? I mean, who would have even thought that tribe even existed? But here you are in Ecuador, and you realized that there's a real need for the support, maybe more the invisible support that I was talking about. And I put in quotes, back home. So tell us what that means about to have, or maybe even to not have, or to need that support from back home.
Oh, wow. That's a could be a lengthy discussion to try to narrow it down.
Yeah.
In the sense that we were asked to come back and serve at headquarters, and it was a real struggle for us because we really loved the people we were ministering with, but really felt the Lord was calling us to come back, so we had to be obedient to that call.
Yeah.
But what that provides and the need for that is the fact that if I was a missionary on the field and I had to figure out how to process all the donations that supported our ministry, yeah, and to take care of all of those needs that happen in this building behind the scenes of health insurance and taking care of all the needs that might happen from an office structure, if I had to do that from a distance by the internet in Ecuador, I would have never had time to gone out to be in relationship and sharing the gospel with people. Yeah. And so this support here helps facilitate the ministry continuing at a much more rapid pace and a much more focus of the relationships that are happening.
I just really appreciate the way that you put that, because we love to follow the work of missionaries. We like to see what they're doing and how they're doing it. But with that burden of having to do all of the administrative stuff, it does really distract from their missionary work. So that's what you get to do now. But there's one little thing that you told me that I want to cover, because when you felt that call to come to back to the States, to the home office, and do that, leaving your post there was difficult. And that village, I'm not sure I'm saying the terminology right, but when the people said, "You love us, we know that, and we love you, why are you leaving?"
Yeah, that's the exact words that were questioned,
yeah,
among tears when we were celebrating our last service in this one, the last Shuar community we were visiting. That's exactly what they asked my wife, or all of us, through tears about that.
Yeah.
And my wife responded and said, "We left good ministry to come here because the Lord called us." Yeah. And now the Lord has had a different call on our lives. And the best thing we can do to love you and to minister to you is to be obedient to where the Lord's calling, yeah, us to be. And so through tears, they accepted that, and they believe that as well, for to be obedient to where the Lord is calling you to serve and, yeah, minister.
I love that, because that's so important, because all of us who really want to be a part of the Great Commission or be a part of God's work anywhere, we need to understand that call, and there will be a price to pay. And if we're comfortable and cozy in a place and we're surrounded by people who love us and we love them, it is extraordinarily difficult to hear that call and then to move on it. So I want to say to listeners, anybody who's thinking, well, gosh, I might be interested in being involved in a ministry, maybe missions overseas or maybe something else, but, and then they say, you know, I've got things kind of going here. So what you're saying, Danny, and maybe you could say it in a really specific, bold way, to tell people, if they even think that God might be calling them, count the cost, and then what? What should they do?
Well, get confirmation. There should always be counselors in your life who, good, can get confirmation, good, through, good, prayer. Does the Lord see this in you? Or do your mentors, do they see this, you living out this ministry? Mm. Meaning, are you ministering somewhere now? If you're not, it may not be called into missions, foreign missions, because there's not a magic plane ride that's going to get you to start sharing the gospel in, right, another country.
Right.
But if you're actively being involved in sharing the gospel, then yeah, it's a good thing to be able to get counsel and be obedient to what the Lord is calling you to do and say yes.
Hear the call, be obedient. I'm going to ask you a question after the break here, Danny, about what you said about your influence. You were very influential, you and your wife, in that place, but now you have a different kind and a different size of influence. So we'll be right back, folks, and we'll have Danny talk about that.
Do you or someone you love need assisted living but are afraid you could never afford the cost? Glasswater Creek of Plainfield is for you. If you income and Medicaid qualify, you can move into Glasswater Creek for a fraction of the cost of market rate assisted living. Glasswater Creek of Plainfield is a game changer, bringing an affordable assisted living option to the west side of Indianapolis. Schedule your visit today at glasswaterplainfield.com or by calling 317-839-5808. That's 317-839-5808. 5808.
I'd like to give a big thank you to the Covenant partners who make this show possible in the Indianapolis area. Thank you to the Ron Blue Trust, Wisdom for Wealth for Life. Find out more about this great partner on our website, mercytoday.global.
I'm Brad Swinford with Salem Concrete Paving. It's a privilege to partner with Mercy, Inc., who provides hope to people around the world by meeting critical needs and introducing people to Jesus. I know that through Mercy, Inc., I'm investing in God's kingdom as they spread the love and gospel of Christ around the world. So please join me in supporting Mercy, Inc. and Mercy Today Radio by praying or going to their website at mercytoday.global. Thank you.
This is Doug Hoffman, Executive Director for Mercy, Inc. I want to thank you for listening to Mercy Today.
We are back and we're talking with Danny Beasley. Danny is the Executive Director of OMS USA, and our title for today's episode is The Invisible Force That Makes Missions Possible. And if you've listened from the beginning, you understand now more about what that means. The invisible force is all the work that Danny and his team does here stateside and making missions possible, because he relieves the missionary from a lot of the administrative and back office sort of work. And so then the missionary can be released to actually fulfill their calling and to do what they were assigned out there to do. So before the break, I asked Danny about the size and scope or shape of his influence. And so let's get back to that, Danny. So, because you told me that about, you had great influence, but you recognized that that was with that group and that every group has the limitations. And compare that to the influence or the support that you offer now on a wide scale to the missionaries scattered abroad.
Wow. That's a great question, because when we were serving in Ecuador, we had an influence in if you look at a map, a very little small speck of the southern Amazon jungle to an indigenous group called the Shuar people. And that was great, and we loved it. And there was a huge impact of multiplication and what happened in people's lives there. But as we reflected on what God was calling us to come back to, that our ministry here flows out. And what you mentioned earlier, we're actually in either with residential missionaries or partners or with national workers in about 75 countries around the world in over 40 languages. So when we came back here to serve, and what we do in this building in Greenwood, Indiana, has an impact on ministry all around the world. Whereas our impact before was in a small part of the southern Amazon basin, now our impact is worldwide.
Yeah. And that's got to be a thrill for you, but I got to ask this. Do you miss being on site in the mission field?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. But thanks to technology, with a young man that I led to the Lord in a church now, that he gets some data on his phone and a signal from the jungle, and he'll call me on WhatsApp.
Wow.
And so he and I have had a number of conversations over the last several years, hearing what the Lord's doing in his life and his family and the ministry in the Shuar communities.
Knowing your background there, I would imagine, tell me if this is correct, that you have your head in the work because you do well at management and coordination and all this stuff. But because you've been in the field, you also have your heart into it.
Yes, correct.
That I
have a great understanding of what happens there now, as opposed to just coming into an executive role without having that experience on the field.
Right, right. That's, how do I want to say, that's golden.
I mean,
that's actually premier, because a lot of missionaries now, they don't have the burden of all the things that you do, and you do that for them. You do it with a smile. You do it with a cheerful heart. I know that. Yeah. So I want to ask this, for the sake of our listeners who want to understand a little bit more about how funding and financing and all that, because nothing that is done in the mission field overseas or in your office is done in a vacuum, and it takes funds to do that. And the people that I know that love to give to missions what they or to anything, actually, what they really appreciate is that concept of leverage. So when they can give to something that expands and grows and is leveraged to something bigger, help us understand how a donor can visualize if they make more of your office work possible through their gifts. How does that leverage the mission work that is being done in all those countries?
It's such a great need. It's a good question to talk about, because leaving the Southern Amazon jungle, and I'm no longer sharing stories in our newsletters about trudging through the rainforest and sharing the gospel out in these communities, these remote areas, and talking about sitting in an office is a very drastic change. And many people have a hard time understanding what's the importance of being here. But out of this office, these offices here in Greenwood, Indiana, we transfer hundreds of thousands of dollars of money around the world every month to be able to continue doing ministry. We recruit, we train, we mobilize, we have the HR and the benefit functions and the communications and marketing to get those stories out that those missionaries are telling about the impact around the world, along with one of the other critical parts that people forget about is the missionary care. That mission life is difficult, especially for them overseas now in a pandemic. And our missionary care people doing everything they can to stay connected by Zoom to minister to and encourage. So there is so much that happens here that's so integral to the success of ministry around the world. And so I just consider us kind of like the hub of making sure everything continues to flow. And when it gets disrupted, like the pandemic, we had to pivot, as the term most people have been using through the pandemic, like everyone else, to make sure the best way possible that we could still continue to do whatever was possible here to maintain a normal structure and a normal flow of ministry in the areas that were still able to be engaged.
And the work of OMS goes on very ambitiously around the world. We have to make adjustments, like you were saying, but you get to be in the middle of all that. You get to coordinate things. So it empowers and leverages all that OMS is seeking to do. I really appreciate that a whole lot. So I've got a couple of other questions before we finish, Danny, and I understand, too, that we may run out of time, but we want our listeners to understand that when we close the radio portion, you can always go to the website and find it as a podcast that is called Afterwards. And that's at mercytoday.global. So, Danny, you had mentioned briefly about the fellow that you led to Christ, and he is now pastoring a church or planting churches. Tell us that story.
His name is Clever, just like the word clever, but K-L-E-V-E-R.
Okay.
And I preached a very evangelistic sermon on Monday, Thursday of April 2016, and then Julie and I left the country in December. So it was a short time frame of building a relationship in this remote community. And Clever sat under this lean-to, under the porch of this house, with leaning against the corner with his arms crossed and a hard look on his face the whole time I preached.
He did not look receptive, right?
Yeah. He was intently watching. And if the Shuar people are the original headhunters, that they would shrink heads. So it's a little intimidating, but they haven't done that for years. It's been illegal. But when I gave the gospel presentation, he didn't hesitate to accept the gospel. Wow. And I have a picture of him on the day he accepted Christ with a hard look on his face.
Yeah.
And I have a picture the last time I saw him with his family, that with the peace that came over him, the transformation that happens because of the power of the gospel. His circumstances didn't change. Yeah. And but yet his countenance had. And he didn't tell us, but the leader of the community said, "Has Clever told you what's happened to him?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Well, after he accepted Christ, over those months between April and November, he had led his whole family to the Lord. Mm-hmm. He had a small canoe. He would go up river, and he had led 11 other people to the Lord in that time by going up and down the river sharing the gospel."
Wow.
So when he and I have had conversations, they were just starting to visit a community called Narvaez, and they have planted a church there now, and he is leading that church in that community. So it's a phenomenal story of one message going out, one person hearing it, and how it's flowing out and making the ripple effect to many others in the community that's impacting and changing people's lives.
Oh,
but
beautiful.
The pictures are so phenomenal because they serve so contrasting to show circumstances didn't change, but the heart did of the transformation.
That's the explosive, life-changing power of the gospel. And I want to make a point here that, Danny, the work that you did in that, that's what we want missionaries to do all around the world. And they are enabled and freed to do that because of the work that you're doing at the home office. And I have to say, unfortunately, our engineer is telling us we're out of time. We're still going to bridge over to the afterwards, but we're going to have to wrap up our radio time here. So we have been talking with Danny Beasley. He is the executive director of OMS USA. And Danny, if you'd like to say one last thing to our audience, how would you phrase it?
Oh, wow. I hadn't processed that question, but that is a great question. What I would say is that when Moses was at the burning bush in Exodus chapter 3, when the Lord called to him out of the bush, his immediate response was, "Here I am." And that wording is more of, "I am here to do whatever, to hear what you have to say and do whatever you ask me."
Yeah.
And I would say if the Lord's calling you to whatever it may be in your personal walk with the Lord, say, "Here I am."
Beautiful. That's absolutely beautiful. Danny Beasley, OMS Executive Director for the USA, and the topic is invisible force, the invisible force that makes missions possible. Do you ever think of yourself as an invisible force, Danny?
Not at all.
No. So, but gosh, I just want to thank you for taking the time with us today. We're going to bridge over to the podcast, to the afterwards, but I want to thank you again so much for being with us today.
Thank you. It's been an honor for me to be here with you.
Okay. Thanks, Danny.
We'll be back with more Mercy Today right after this.
This is Doug Hoffman, the Executive Director for Mercy, Inc. I want to introduce you to our Mercy Minutes. Today I'm going to take you to South Asia. And as we look at South Asia, we've planted over 4,100 water wells for drinking water and for cattle. And as those wells have gone into villages, they've transformed lives. Because before that, oftentimes the job of bringing water home fell on the mother or the wife. And sometimes she would walk for an hour to get to clean water. That's one way, and then walk for an hour back. All of a sudden, she had more time to spend with her children. All of a sudden, she had more time to be able to have conversation. There was more time with which we could share Christ with her. More time to learn more about who Jesus really is. It's empowering.
I really appreciate having the opportunity to talk with Danny, because there's a guy with the head and the heart both fully invested in missions. And I say not just missions, but in the Great Commission. It is helping people to come to faith in Christ, to hear, understand, and respond to the message of the gospel. Friend, if you have questions about today's topic, want to get in touch with Danny, have more questions about his work or Mercy, because this is a show about Mercy, and we want to invite you to give us a heads up. Tell us you'd like more information. Go to our website, mercytoday.global. We have a contact form. You can ask a question or provide some information. If you have suggestions about other guests or other topics, we'd be happy to receive those. Also, we would like to be in your inbox every week, so we will send you by email a link for our shows. I want to thank you for listening today. And this is Mercy Today, telling the story of how compassion changes everything. I'm your host, Dr. Dan Critchett, wrapping up this episode. Until next time, may God help you be a part of what He is doing in our world today.